coaches, it's 3 o'clock. We'll go ahead and get started. We're going to be having Coach Loren Endsley speak with us this, I guess you can say, this afternoon or this evening, depending on what coast you're on. Coach Endsley's got, I don't know if you guys are all know, but I posted a couple of his stuff on our page. He's got some presentation stuff on CoachTube, and me being a Duck fan, as soon as he posted something up about working Ducks, I immediately went in there, real reasonably priced. I think it's like $15, something like that. Amazing information. So, Coach Endsley, if you just introduce yourself, my man, and it's all yours, sir.
Yeah, I'll get this thing started and kind of share and everything. Now, this isn't like a full bore clinic presentation, you know. I kind of wanted to get some opinions and talk some football and talk some screen game. And I put some of our most successful screens together and some film and stuff like that. But, you know, we've been doing so many of these clinics. I really would like just some feedback and some conversation, really, you know. Kind of like a round table on screen talk, but I did put together some stuff. Real quick, let me pop this open, share screen. So if you guys have any questions, feel free to ask away, and we'll get started. Just real quick, just utilizing the screen game to get playmakers in space. A little bit about myself. Played offensive line at Idaho State and Eastern Oregon University. And then I was a high school head coach at Lake Roosevelt in Washington. During that time, I ran offensive line academy and worked with the NFL Combine Pro Day group. Had several draft picks come out of there, especially offensive line is where I kind of specialized in. And then I became the offensive line coach at Eastern Oregon University, where I played. Had a lot of success there. We were top 25 rushing team, coached All-American there, coached another two all-conference players as well. Then I became the offensive coordinator at Dakota Wesleyan University. The past two seasons I've been out there, got fortunate enough to coach another All-American offensive lineman, and we had a top 20 passing offense, and we used a ton of screens, especially RPO-wise. We used a lot of the screen game there. And now I just recently took the job as assistant offensive line coach at University of South Dakota over here in Vermilion. So I'm really excited to get that started. Crazy time to have a transition though, that's for sure. Doing all your meetings and greetings through Zoom isn't ideal, but we're making it work for sure. But just real quick, you know, why to use the screen game? It's taking advantage of aggressive pass rushers, and we will do this really early in games to try to wear out some defensive players, you know, get them running sideline to sideline. We're going to get our playmakers in space, get those athletes the ball in space, and let's see what happens. And I really do believe you can steal some yards through the screen game. I think it's one of the easiest way to steal yards. One of my biggest regrets as an offensive coordinator is that I didn't run enough screens, you know. And then if you have athletic offensive linemen, it's a great tool to get those big boys out in space and running. And it's not extremely expensive. You do need to put some time into the screen game, but I don't feel it's extremely expensive to carry, especially the different variations you can use and different things like that. I'm going to show a couple easy RPOs that we used, and they were some of our easiest RPOs that we actually utilized. So as we get started here, just going to look in here. And like I said, it's not all put together in a clinic presentation. Haven't been able to get to office, things like that. But I wanted to put some stuff together for Coach here. But the first one that we use a lot is our slide screen. And the basic version of that is having out a 3x1 set, having the most inside guy run a slide. Right here, we'll also do this a ton with a tight end or wing position as an RPO variation. We've also mixed around with it in the backfield.
Hey, Coach, are you on a different screen? Because the only thing that I'm seeing is why you screens.
Really?
Yes, sir.
One second.
Oh, there you go.
All right, here, we good?
Sir.
All right. So So right here, like I'm talking about with the slide screen, the most basic variation that we have is this a 3x1 open. We can also put that in a wing alignment. We've also mixed it up with split backs and it actually being the play side running back coming across and running a slide. We did that a lot with inside zone read, but it's just an easy RPO. It can be as simple as just numbers and giving your quarterback, hey, if you got 3 versus 2 on the outside there, throw the slide screen. One of the guys that I think utilizes this the most is Scott Frost. He did it a ton at UCF and did it a ton at Nebraska as well. And just finding ways to and formations to give your guys easy reads. And then another one that I want to talk about was just a swing screen. And that's really the one that I feel like I should have utilized more as an offensive coordinator. Just calling a swing screen and putting a passing concept on the opposite side, some quick game. I like to do slants because it's an easy cover one beater right there. And if you got the receivers to do it, you have answers on both sides. But these are two of the most easy screens I think you can put in that aren't very time expensive and your guys can get really good at them. And they're great in the RPO world. So I got some film of us utilizing these. So again, I mean, this isn't going to be groundbreaking or anything like that, but I do think if you can formation the defenses you're going against and you can find matchups and use motions to get guys open and create easy throws, I think this simple screen where you cut everybody at the offensive line position, you just cut the aggressive defenders right there, and then you get the ball out in space on a swing is a great variation, doesn't take a lot of time, and this is kind of what I'm talking about right here. Just this was just a base. We're going to run the swing to the right here. Okay, and then we ran it out on the opposite side with this receiver. And essentially what we're telling our quarterback here, we call this pass screen options. Basically, if you have the out 100%, you can take the out if you want it or whatever quick game tag. It can be hitches. It can be slants. It doesn't really matter. But if you have that for 100%, just take it. And that's all a pre-snap read. If not, you're going to throw the swing. And it's not a read or anything like that. We know formationally we're going to have the advantage, especially when you go 3x1 open like this picture right here. You're essentially getting yourself into a quad look where you're going to have four guys on the perimeter. So for a defense to pre-snap to that is very unlikely. So just a simple swing, get that guy out in space. You know, hopefully your guys on the perimeters can block. We have to spend a lot of time with our guys on that, and they don't always get the job done. But using simple swings, and one team that I thought really utilized this concept and using – these simple concepts was North Carolina at the tempo that they play. And I've always been a up-tempo, no huddle team. Plays like this are huge for your offense. How's the quality of film? Is it choppy or anything like that?
No, it's not bad.
Perfect. It's good. It's at the right speed to where we can see what's going on.
Perfect. But like right here, you can see we're going to have that advantage. Whoever is going to be that fourth defender, it's either going to be a linebacker inside the box or a safety high. Most times when you go 3x1 open, those are their only options. And you're getting that playmaker out in space, and then who knows what's going to happen after that. But up front, we just cut everybody on this. Not the prettiest of cuts. But we just use our base half man, half slide rules. So if you are going to be manned up, so for instance right here, this right tackle in our base rules would be manned up on 94. He's going to cut 94. This is our slide, so they're all going to cut to their left. So they're just going to cut their gap. We make it real easy. Don't try to add too much to the O-line on this play. It's simply just a cut tag for them, and they're all going to cut through. But you can see right here, now we get a playmaker out in space, and we can do something with it. Here's another example. Again, here, aggressive defense, brought a lot of pressure. So right here, he took the free access throw. That's what we call this, is a free access right here. He felt like he had the leverage and he just took it. The biggest thing that I would say with that is it kind of depends on how much trust you want to give your quarterback. As an offensive coordinator, I probably did give my guys too much trust. Too many options can kind of hamper it, but I always wanted my guys to – I wanted to steal the easy yards. So, like, right here, we know we have the leverage there. Just throw it out there. So, we just tagged different concepts on it depending on the week, depending on how the corners played it. I think that's a big thing when you're breaking down defense. Not just, you know, what front are they in, what blitzes do they do, what coverages, but what technique is that individual guy using? If you can kind of break a team down like that, it's a lot easier and it's going to give your guys the position to be successful. Right here, if you would have thrown the swing, we would have been good as well. Again, full cuts. Not the prettiest, but we got it done. Now, right here, this is my favorite way to run a swing is out of split backs and having a motion player come across in an orbit right here. Because a lot of times, especially down in the goal line, red zone area, what you're going to get is a lot of cover one looks. And what's going to happen, as you can see on the film, whoever's covering this guy is going to have to work through some trash. There's going to be some miscommunication. Again, like I said, we go really fast, really up-tempo. There's going to be some miscommunication with the motion part of it, and you can catch this, catch a defense. And, again, I'm not trying to beat the defensive coordinator I'm going against. I'm trying to outsmart the players he has. So when you can use high tempos and you can use motions, I think it's a huge advantage. Really just becomes a race to the pylon at that point. Right here, and you out-leverage the guy as well. And right here, we're pairing this with a quick game on the other side with a slant, okay? But really, you can pair this with, I mean, any kind of run game with a five-man. You can pair it with, like, locked inside zone, anything like that, stretch, anything like that that you want to pair it with. It's an easy screen, not expensive. And it's really just if you got some playmakers, get them the ball out in space. Right here, we didn't have the cut tag. We just had our guys stay up. But they're just running their half man. Nice thing about this is you get to keep your running back in the protection. You get an extra guy just in case you need it. Right here, just another swing. This is out of 2x2. But really, I mean, we call it pass screen options. It's nothing groundbreaking or anything like this. We were playing the national champs in this game right here. We had to find ways to steal yards, so we did things like this. But essentially, all we did was put a swing on one side, which we still have the numbers. But on the other side, we put slants and told our quarterback, if you feel you have the leverage, take it. Again, it's trying to understand who you're playing against and trying to get your quarterbacks and players to understand. What they did a lot with their defense is try to wall this player out. So we felt pretty strongly that if we can get the underneath slant just to take it, because there's going to be all that space, as you see right here, the mic is going to go with the running back. And we're just going to attack that space that's vacated. That was a pretty good team. We had to come up with some unique ways to attack them for sure. Moving on to the slide. The slide's a screen that I really like. It's just taking the most inside guy, making sure that he's behind the line of scrimmage, and then blocking MDM right here. It's going to give you numbers on the perimeter a lot of times. So right here, that number three guy is really right here. And we felt like we have leverage on that. We're going to take it. And we feel as long as you can get 5 yards, this play is as good as a run. And then, you know, who knows what happens in space. A lot of times if you're playing against guys that aren't the greatest tacklers, a five-yard gain can turn into something big. Right here, the key block is really this guy right here because he has to block MDM. So as he comes off the ball, he's really – his main threat is this guy right here. But as you see, he sits and the safety comes up. He's just going to take that guy as the main threat as this guy backs up and you get the slide off. Again, up front, we're just full cutting. Here's another example of the slide. Besides playoffs, we had the second most yards against these guys, and this was on their national championship team. And really, a ton of the yards just came on quick, simple screens like this, trying to utilize that space that's out there. Up front, we knew it was going to be a big-time battle as they had like three All-American D linemen. So this allowed us to cut those guys up front, slow them down a little bit, and get the ball out in space.
Coach, who are you playing in this film?
Morningside from Iowa.
10-4.
Yeah, the last two national champs. Really great team, well-disciplined, just trying to utilize some of these schemes to steal yards, really. Right here is just another example. It's just a simple screen.
I've been.
Yeah?
Hi.
But this is a slide screen. A lot of times what we'll do is we'll actually do a check with me when we see the numbers that we like. So for this instance right here, this was a check with me play. We felt like we had the leverage on the outside. You know, really your threats on this are this guy, the inside backer who's still going to have to run there to get there, and then the safety who's still deep. So we weren't really too concerned. These guys were playing pretty off. So you can really utilize some of these screens as a check with me as well. This is an RPO variation of it. Real simple. We put it on the front side of our locked inside zone. So, again, what I talked about was giving your quarterback options. And right here, that's exactly what we did. We did that at a two-by right here, and he's going to block the corner, and then you're going to get your slide coming from this player right here. And really what we wanted to pick on was they in particular, when the back is away from them, use this guy as the extra run fitter. You know, if we're talking about run fits and everything like that, we know they have to have an extra run fit on this side. And whenever the back was away from them, they use that outside linebacker. So we really want to run this on the front side of our locked inside zone. So right here is a great example. We basically told our quarterback, if you have the leverage here, just take it. And that's what we got on it. I think that's really crucial. If you're an RPO-based team, is giving – because defenses, what they're doing so often right now, are basing everything on where the running back is. So you really have two options at that point. If you want to be a pistol team and do a lot out of pistol, that'll help you. But if you're not going to go pistol and you want to do some gun stuff, you're going to have a solution, or they're just going to always have their extra run fit available for you. So, like, this is a perfect example. We knew this guy was going to play the run anytime the back was away, so we just put something on the front side. And I do think it's critical to have front side RPOs if you're going to be successful in an RPO-based offense, which we were at Dakota Wesleyan in the last 2 years. I think this is the last one, but this is one that I got from Scott Frost when he was at UCF. He basically, you're going to run inside zone read right here, and the play side running back is going to run your slide. So if the quarterback keeps it right here, you have these guys blocking for the slide out here. Quarterback keeps it right here. And if he feels like we have leverage there, he's just going to throw it. It gets a little bit tricky when you're going to start running zone read, just because there's a whole another issue there with 51 being able to redirect.
What's the quarterback looking at right here?
So right here, his first read, first question, his first read's the defensive end that's right over here. So that's his first read. If he gives us a run read or a running back read, we're just going to give it to the running back right away and not mess with it. If he gives us what he gets right here is a quarterback pull read, okay? At that
10-4.
Point, at that point, the quarterback should look up at 23, and if he feels like he has the leverage, he can get it out there.
Roger that.
Yep. It can be tricky, like I'm saying, it can get really tricky when you're starting to do read plays. But we feel that that guy often got lost. Oklahoma will do this quite a bit, but they do it more off their stretch, which is a really good scheme that they have. But we feel like when that guy comes across, he kind of gets lost in there a little bit. And it was a good one for us. Is there any questions on the swings or the slides at all?
Hey, Coach, I got a question. I noticed that, like, that slide route is kind of like an arrow. Do you have, like, advantages of that versus, like, swing, like, where the guy's bubbling?
Yeah, I feel like it's attacking more right away. There's advantages to both, but I feel like it attacks more right away, whereas the swing, you have a little bit more time from, like, the safety angle, whereas the slide's going to be more aggressive and more downfield, if that makes sense.
Yes, sir.
But I think there's benefits to both for sure.
Excellent.
The other one I didn't have any film of, but one of them that I like a lot is using it as a quarterback run game as well. So what I mean by the swing part of it is either going quarterback insert inside zone or quarterback counter even and burst motioning that running back. And right there, you're going to have a tell real quick. That essentially what I'm talking about is that extra guy that's in the box. You burst motion the running back, which just means kind of just go. And when you burst that running back, that linebacker has this choice right there to make. He either has to go out with the running back on the swing or stay in the box. And I feel like that's one of the simplest RPOs. If you're going to start with RPOs, and you're going to run your quarterback and you're not worried about running your quarterback, that's where you should start because it's so simple. And that linebacker cannot hesitate at all or the swing's going to be gone. Some ways that we used it, like I said, was the inside zone insert quarterback run, the quarterback counter, and then a GT quarterback bash kind of concept. And those are all – I mean, if you guys need any film on that, I have so many examples from Oklahoma running it. But all those different ways is just such a crystal clear picture for your quarterback. Moving on. As we talk about now getting into actual true screen game, the ones that we start with, we'll start with this version right here, which is just a now tunnel screen where we're just getting it out there. And I teach this one first, and you can tag whatever concept you want on the backside. It doesn't really matter, but this is a pass screen option again. Tag whatever you want. I like to tag slants onto this one just because what's going to be a now screen or a tunnel now screen, whatever you want to refer to it as, is man press coverage, right? So that's going to be your number one thing that's going to beat that. So on the other side, I put what we kind of specialize in slants at Dakota Wesleyan. So I put slants on there because it's a great beater and we felt like we always won that matchup. So now you're giving your quarterback two options and he can be successful either way. And this is what we start with. So this backside guys have slants. Your slot's going to block the corner out here. And this is off our half man, half sort protection. Your backside tackle is going to be locked on the defensive end. Your backside guard is going to be locked on a three tech. If he has anything else, he's what's called a rat killer. And essentially, he's looking for any D lineman that's slow playing, any backer that's slow playing, that's reading the screen really well. And it's his job to make sure he gets in front of that guy legally with all the new rules and everything going in. Depending on what state you're in, just make sure that you're coaching it the right way. Because a lot of the blocks when I was playing, this was, I don't want to say kill shot, but this was a, I mean, you got to really take it out on somebody and come back down to the line of scrimmage. But I know in a lot of states that's not allowed anymore. So you got to teach it correctly and get that guy in front of the defender. The center is really working Mike to clean up. So we try to – it depends on where the ball is as far as hash goes. But we try to tell him he's really looking for the cleanup of the Mike linebacker or anything else that's flowing over the top. And then the right guard is our alley player, and we teach him to get out to the alley. We do a lot of drills on this to work it. We do a lot of screen timing, things like that, to make sure that he understands where that location is and where it could be. And then our right tackle is locked on the defensive end, and he's looking to run that guy directly upfield. But this is how we start our screens off, is teaching them this. And like I said, we'll do a lot of work with this. But then what we do is we move on to the next level of that same screen, because I coach offensive line. So when I was an offense coordinator, everything was designed to make their world as easy as possible. So right here, we have a dual screen, okay? And we're going to have a swing on one side and a now on the other side. The center to right tackle are all running the same now screen that I just showed you. Nothing changes for those guys. Now, on what we consider the backside, the tackle right here is going to flash set real fast. And it's really important that you teach guys how to be good actors. He needs to, you know, kick his head back, you know, show hands real quick, try to get that defensive end to go upfield before he goes flat to the numbers. And the biggest thing I can tell you guys on the difference between successful screen games and poor screen games is your offensive lineman going flat. Teach them how to go as flat as possible, so that they can pick up guys. It's a lot of the same premise when you're talking about go to where the guy's going to be and not where he's at. Because if he, for whatever instance, sees a safety up here and he starts running at the safety, he's going to miss him by a mile. He needs to go flat and understand that safety is going to come down. And we, like I said, we did a ton of screen drills to make sure our guys understood angles and how to own your angle. Now, the backside guard here is going to set. He's going to 1-1000-2 count, and then he's going to release to the alley looking for the mic to any cleanup. So it's a very similar job that the center has on the now screen portion of this. The quarterback here is really reading the defensive end here. If that defensive end does what we call a peel technique, which means he takes off after the running back on the swing, he's just going to turn and throw the now. If that defensive end chases down or goes upfield, we're going to get that swing out to the perimeter. I got a question about the Z's footwork for this. We've done three up, two back to the ball. We've also done the turning and looking for the ball straight away. I prefer to do the three up, two back, just because it sells it a little bit more. You can get that corner dropping a little bit more and trying to get better leverage there. But I've also done it where it's just a quick turn and get the ball right away. Kind of depends. On this one's going to be slower developing, so we've always done it three up, two back. When we've done the just straight now screen, we've done that as a quick turn right away and throw, because the quarterback essentially is making it a pre-snap read. So on this play right here on the now screen, he knows right away if it's cover one press, this is not an option, so he's going to turn here anyway. Whereas if it's not that cover one press, this guy is going to get the ball right away. It is literally catch and throw for the quarterback, and it's going to happen right away. So we'll do more just turning, looking at that way. But we've kind of messed with it both ways. But some of the different variations you can do on this as well with this screen right here is burst motioning the back. So just send the back early And what that'll do is kind of tell you what the coverage is as well, and kind of give your back a leverage on this backer. If they're in man, it'll give your back some leverage on that throw. Another one is a running back pause, which I wish I had film of. Temple uses a lot. I know Fresno State did a couple years ago. But essentially what they're doing on the pause is this running back comes out and then stops right here. And I think this is a great variation. I haven't ran it myself, but I plan to. And like I said, Temple's done it a lot. But sometimes what you're going to get if you just run a swing is that your running back is going to outrun the offensive line here. He should be outrunning him for the most part. But what you do when you pause him right here is it gives these guys a chance to get out in front of the play. So that's a great variation to the same play. And then, crack. You can have your Y and X come down legally and crack, and then that puts your play side tackle, still going to the numbers, but the guy that he's going to have to pick up there is going to be the corner, if that makes sense. Crack's a great variation, especially if you know you're getting man. What I would like to do a lot with that is to burst the running back and then crack it still, because what's going to end up happening is that corner, when you know you're getting man, is going to follow the X here, and now you have a ton of room to the outside in the perimeter. Got another question. Is there any questions on this before we get to the film? Perfect. So right here, what we're going to have out of the pistol is our swing here and our now here. So as we look, our quarterback's just looking at this defensive end, does an inside move, which is perfect for us. Outside receiver was a true freshman for us this last year. He thinks we're cracking. He's got the wrong call. He should be working up to that corner. The nice thing about screens, though, is sometimes it'll kind of clean itself out. You can see right here why it's crucial for that play side tackle to go flat. Right here, this isn't his guy, but he knows he has to go flat to the numbers, and we never pass up dirty shirts. So he goes, gets enough of him right there to get this off. Good move by the running back at the end. But he should be out there a lot faster than the guard. It kind of doesn't time out exactly perfect because the guard's uncovered. But he's really just flashing and going as fast as he can. Now, one of the things I absolutely hate by the right guard here is we try to teach a club release as much as possible. So right here, as he releases, he should really be taking his inside hand, which would be his left hand, and clubbing the back of this defender as hard as he possibly can before moving on and going flat. He's kind of just being lazy there. Before working up. On the backside, or on the now part of this right here, you can see the issue kind of with that pressed up corner. We need to dig this guy out. And luckily we didn't have to throw it to that side because that would have been pretty bad. Up front, they're just running their screen, or their half man, half sort. So these guys are just running their screen. Right here, you can see the center doing a good job of that club release that we talked about. So he's just taking that backside hand and shoving that guy down before he releases. Oregon this year has some monsters that when you watch their screen game, I mean, they're just getting after people. And they club them, I mean, real, really, really well. Right here, I put this example in here because part of it is the quarterback as well. You have to teach the quarterback what we call feathering, which means getting off the ball in any of your screen game. Otherwise, you're leaving him exposed. So right here, this quarterback should be feathering back. Okay, he should be coming back here. Otherwise, you're going to leave him exposed just like that. You know, and that's a hard lesson you have to learn. But make sure your guys understand that if they just are going to stand there, they're going to take something. Right here, we have a crack call on. Really, what needs to happen is we need to go flat here. And why I like the crack so well is you can see what happens in this man. That corner gets sucked in as we get going. Now they don't have any leverage on the swing, and we can get it out.
Coach, could you go back and show that wide clip of that one more time? Yeah, yep. Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, I don't know why more teams – I don't know why more people don't crack you. Oh, yeah, I mean, not always, but you usually get a 2-for-1.
Yeah, you know, for sure. And
especially to the boundary.
What?
Especially to the boundary.
Yeah. And we would want our receiver to be physical right here, head to the outside. But again, right here, I think it's important when you're coaching your offensive linemen.
In man,
what?
Coach, when you get man, do you usually push crack there?
Yeah, yep, we try to.
Coach, can you hear me?
Yep, yeah, with man, it's perfect.
And when you get man, do you – yeah, that's my question, thanks.
You kind of cut out there. But, you know, as the offensive line coach, I'll take a little bit of responsibility for this. You can't have your guys so worried about getting out that they don't take care of things first. So this is a little bit on the quarterback, but it's a lot on the right guard as well. He should have a 1-1002 before releasing, and then he should really look to club that guy as hard as he can. Now with that guy going inside on him with his right hand, I'll give him a little bit of – leeway because he was playing with a broken hand at the time. But what essentially this is a combination of the quarterback not getting enough depth and then the offensive line not really clubbing that guy hard enough because the offensive lineman was so worried about getting out. Here's a great example. You know, but this is really where, you know, I'm making a huge change as far as how I look at the screen game. This dual screen is something that they've been running forever. Chip Kelly ran it a ton. But with this stop, with the running back stopping, it's really going to allow your offensive lineman to get out cleanly and help. And when you watch the film like Temple from this last year, or Indiana from this last year, when you watch the film of that, you can really see that where having this guy stop is actually going to be a huge advantage to get those guys out in front. But again, right here is a great example of the left guard. That's what a club release should look like right there. And honestly, it's just using the defender's momentum against them. These guys are already rushing hard upfield. Make them pay for that. Their body is already going towards. Hopefully, they're already going low, playing with low pad level. And all you're doing is using that momentum against them. Here's another example of Morningside. And, I mean, this is a team that will trigger pretty fast. But, again, you know, you're getting a playmaker out in space. You know, it gives you a chance to do something with it. And, like, right here, we don't get any alignment out. But here's another good example of a club right here by the left guard. Our tackle really needs to get just go right here, getting too involved with that guy. Any other questions about the dual screen? Good. All right. This is my favorite screen. Right here. It's just a running back crack screen. Like you guys talked about, the boundary is a great time to use this. Anytime we're feeling like we're getting a lot of man. And like I said, we've been an RPO-based offense. We get a ton of cover one. We get a ton of man looks all the time. Just part of what we see a lot. And this running back crack screen for us was a huge play. And it was super simple. Again, it's another pass screen option. Like I said, I like to give my quarterback a ton of options, a ton of freedom. But you can pair any quick game you want on one side. And this is off our half man, half sort rules. So what you're going to get a lot, if a defensive coordinator is pretty good, he's going to recognize your protections. For instance, if your running back's always on your man side, he's going to blitz it a lot. So what I like on this one is if you can try to set that defensive coordinator up and he starts blitzing your running back side a ton because he realizes that's where the protection is, start running this a lot. It'll help you because the blitzers will come right past it. Quarterback will get the ball off to the races. But it's really great against man. Essentially what we tell the slot receiver is that he has the number one in the box. The outside receiver has the alley player, which is going to be the number two. And we have a whole point system and everything like that that kind of helps these guys out a little bit on that. But essentially all you'd have to tell them is number one in the box, number two. So as we go, this is a faster screen. It's 1-1002 and go. Left tackle should hi-hat release to the numbers, and he's really going to be thinking corner at that point. Left guard should hi-hat flat release to alley. Now these two guys are essentially selling the man protection rules of it, while the center to backside tackle are all selling the slide or sort protection of it. The running back's going to take an outside step, an inside step, and then plant, turn, and be flat and fast. We want those guys to get out of there. We want these guys to catch the ball right around here. And once they get the ball, they should look to read the blocks of their offensive line. Also out of this, we have a 3-by-1, which I actually like this one a lot. Just whatever combination you want on the backside, you can have right there. One is now cracking the first in the box. It's a great concept. Something that we've messed a little bit with is making it an unbalanced formation, putting one of these guys up on the ball, taking him back a little bit, and then in motioning him so he gets a running start at that guy. It's one of the things we've messed with a little bit, which I think is pretty good way to do it. But yeah, same rules apply. Nothing changes for anybody. Just the outside receiver has to know that he's got one. So right here is an example. We're running it to the right. And it cracks by the receivers. And I'm just going to tell you, we weren't perfect at everything. And, you know, we can be a lot better right here at the slot, getting the head on the outside. And then we can be a lot better at the guard of not passing up dirty color right there. But what you're going to see, I mean, especially when you do a 3-by-1, a lot of coverages are going to lean towards the three receiver side. So you're just basically wasting those guys that are playing on that side. You get number three here that gets caught up. I think somebody said it earlier about getting 2-for-1. This quarterback does a good job of feathering, protecting himself. One of the things you kind of have to teach a little bit is throwing it over that guy, which I mean, you shouldn't have to coach it too hard, but you will have to coach it a little bit, is just throwing it over that guy. And we simply at practice just made him, when we did screen timing, throw over one of the coaches. Right, here's another example. You know, situationally, obviously everyone loves calling screens on third down. We try to call them on first down too, especially after a big game. This was just a third down play for us we felt pretty good about. And that was a true freshman at running back who had a pretty phenomenal year. But again, it's just getting your big hogs out in space, moving. And then a playmaker at that point. Receivers working downfield. Not a huge fan of it, but I did let my guys. So in this case right here, when this guy came in, I let him club with his outside hand and do a 360 here. Wasn't a huge fan of it, but I did allow my guys to do it if that's something they felt comfortable with. I just told them you better be able to get back on your track flat and get going. Great blocking downfield too by number 8. You can see I kind of favored it to the 3-by-1. I just think there's so many advantages to it. I think you get so much coverage rolled over to the three receiver side, kind of makes it easy. But again, I mean, this was a pretty good running back, smaller than anything, but tough as nails, and you get a playmaker in space. And I just think, especially nowadays, just if you can get it to the perimeter, get it to the edge, force them to tackle you, I think is huge. I don't think tackling is as good as it once was. And if you can get it in space, you're going to have a chance. But again, just getting that ball just up over the defensive lineman. Super easy screen, not too hard to coach. Doesn't take a ton of time. Here's a really good example of the coverage just rolling to that side. Everyone over here. Right here is an example. We try to set this up as much as we can with the swing that I showed you out of split backs. So we ran that swing like 3 or 4 times this game. And then we set this one up, which I love, where we pumped the swing and then came back to that same running back screen. So it's really just about how can you manipulate the defense and make them think one thing when it's really not. And my offensive line doesn't even know this stuff is going on behind them. It's the same play that we've been running. The running back's running. It's a slightly different because he's coming across action, but he's getting lost. You have motion going one way, swing, which we already hit 3 or 4 times in this game. So you're getting them thinking about that. It's 3rd and 3. Get those defensive players thinking. And, you know, we had a really small running back. Get him lost in the fold with everything. And that's really what happened there. So if you are a fast tempo team, utilize the motions, make it easy. But this wasn't a huge install for us. But for the defense, you know, it's a lot to think about. again. I think the more times you can get one of your playmakers in space, I mean, these are college athletes still, and tackling is pretty shoddy. Any questions on the running back quick screen? All right, moving on. I have a full slide running back screen. This is off our full slide protection, obviously. And what we basically do on our full slide is take the gap to our right or left, and then the running back takes the defensive end on the backside. So if that's something you do, this is a pretty good screen off that. We're really, really unique in the fact that our full slide, we don't take slide sets. We take karaoke steps, so we're actually stepping behind ourselves, and our quarterback will actually do a slight roll into the B gap. So it's a really great screen for us because we get all that flow going one way, and then we throw it back. It's almost like a throwback, but not a full rollout by the quarterback. Again, like the other ones, it's a pass screen option with any quick game you want. I always think it's best if it's outbreaking, just because, again, you're trying to get flow going one way and then throw it back the other way. The biggest thing on this is just that your running back's a good actor when he goes to block the defensive end. He needs a fake like he misses the block, which is great because that's a tough block anyway. So if you can hit this early in games, it gets those defensive ends thinking more. It gets them thinking a little bit more, and it'll slow them down, which is awesome. Your left tackle is still going to go – he's going to sell full slide before flat releasing to the numbers. Your left guard's going to sell full slide before flat releasing to the alley. So essentially, it's very similar to the last screen we went over. It's just how are you getting there and what are the initial steps. Your center is going to full slide before being the rat killer cleanup guy, and he's just looking for anything back there. You can also crack this one. If you are feeling you're getting a ton of man or you just want to crack it, this is one that you can definitely crack. So right there, we just motioned into bunch. This is to a single receiver, so he knows, and it's crack rules, so he knows he has first in the box, which is going to be this guy. Quarterback's going to run like he's setting up in B gap before throwing it back. And again, this takes a little bit more time, so it does allow your offensive linemen to get out in front. Great job by the left tackle right here. I really like this concept from the start just because, you know, you start in a 3-by-1 with attached tight end, and then you motion in a bunch, so you get everyone coming back in. We didn't do a ton of bunch last year, so it wasn't something that I'd seen a lot. And then you get all the flow going that way right here. So you can see the coverage, what you're getting from those guys. And before they realize, it's too late because now you have the angle and you have the leverage on those guys. But just watching the offensive line technique, it is very unique, very different. Something I picked up when I played and coached at Eastern Oregon, but it's karaoke stepping. It's a lot wider of a full slide. And you can see the center struggling with it a little bit, but you're going to try to get all that flow going one way. The defensive linemen think they have the quarterback, then you're going to throw it back. So it's a lot like a throwback out of sprint out, if you guys do any of that stuff, but it's just out of our full slide that – again, we're just changing the pocket on our full slide. We're just changing it to B gap. Quarterback usually sets up right in this B gap right here. So we're trying to get all that movement and then just throw it back. Here's an example from when I was at Eastern Oregon. Don't have any it was a wide shot on this. But right here, I thought the running back did a great job of being an actor, faking like he's blocking that guy and then getting rid of him. So next time he has to block that guy's going to be thinking a little bit more. And then at Eastern Oregon, we also sent out our front side guard as well. Real quick, is there any questions on that full slide? Perfect. Just going over how you coach it and how you get better at this. One of the ways we did it was called screen timing. And this is something we did at least once a week. We invested in it quite a bit just because we wanted our paths to get better and everything like that. And you could see the film. I mean, it wasn't always great, but it did help us and did allow us to be successful on our screen game. You're pretty efficient. Essentially, for the running back screen right here, what we had is those tackle rings. If you have those, utilize those as much as possible. And what we did is we had the first guy in the box be one of the tackle rings, and we had the safety be one of the tackle rings. Then you had the second guy and the corner right here. So the X is coming down to crack this guy. The Y is hitting a moving target. Your tackle right here is going flat to the numbers up to the corner. And then your backside guards releasing to that safety that's probably going to be your biggest threat right there. So we would work screen timing a lot, and we'd get a ton of reps in very fast through this. At times when I was at Eastern Oregon, we actually had this set up with the left side going at one time and the right side going 5 yards ahead of them. And, I mean, it moved really fast, but we had enough coaches and we had enough players where it worked out really well. Right here is just that now screen part of it, where you're trying to get that H coming out to the corner, okay? And then you have the guard and centers players right here, and they're those tackling rings, and you just kind of roll those over, and you have guys pick them up. But that's how we work screen timing. And then a lot of times what we also did is have two quarterbacks right here, one throw the swing and one throw the now, just so that our guys can get used to it and get as many reps as possible as we work that. Real quick, before I answer any final questions, like Coach talked about, some of the presentations and stuff that I have done up in CoachTube are out there. And if you want, I have my information at the end. I can give you guys all discounts on it, but Hands and Pass Pro is my biggest one. It's got a lot of really good reviews on it. And it's basically a case study on teaching your hands and pass protection. And it's a full system on how to teach offensive linemen correct hand placement, different moves, what to do when you're getting beat, tools of leverage, things like that. I also have the Oregon Ducks football techniques used for stretch. So these are all the techniques that you that Oregon utilized. So I have the last 2 years of Oregon football broken down, and I went through every time they ran stretch, and I took out the techniques that they used. Especially this last year, they were the best offensive line in college football. I don't think it's really disputable, and their techniques are awesome. So I felt like making a presentation, and like Coach said, it's $15. Get a hold of me, and I'll get you a discount to make it even cheaper. And then the last one just to talk about is Baltimore Ravens quarterback run game. These are all on CoachTube, but this is just breaking down how the Ravens utilize Lamar Jackson. So if you have an athletic quarterback that can get some stuff done in the run game, a lot of great ideas there, and they do a lot of unique stuff that is really exciting to watch. Is there any questions on anything? Coach, are you there?
Mike? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No questions from anybody? Well, Coach Endsley, hey, I appreciate you coming on here and taking some time with us, man. I know, we had said it earlier that, going to be kind of amazed when next year comes around if more clinics aren't just done online and nobody's showing up at convention centers or hotel rooms anymore. I never really thought of it that way, but you brought up a great point. Most of the people that are coming on here and speaking are high school level coaches. And what, you know, the big thing is, you know, I'm not trying to toot my own horn or anything like that, but some buddies of mine and, you know, we came up with an idea of like creating a page that about coaches basically teaching coaches, you know what I mean? And that it wasn't that somebody's like, hey, buy my playbook, you know, or buy my system for $1,000 a year or something like that. It was about sharing information. So like always, man, I really appreciate you coming on here and doing this for us, you know, for not even a penny, and then offering discounts on your product that's on CoachTube. If you put your information up, man, I'll definitely utilize it, because I've purchased one of your programs. Of course, like I said, because I'm a Ducks fan, you know, dude, it's great, great stuff. I know, not speaking for everybody, but I have always struggled in running screens, and I'm all, you know, I understand X's and O's, and I'm always looking at ways to kind of teach it better, or maybe that's a better technique, and maybe I should be using it that way, man. So, you know, I appreciate you. Sure. Yeah, anybody, yeah, I'm going to, let me write this one down real quick. If anybody's got any questions, right now would be it. And if not, I will end this, and then we'll try to get this thing posted up on our page. Get a hold of Coach, man. Good products on CoachTube. You won't be disappointed.
And just, hey, feel free to reach out to me, Twitter, phone, anything like that. I mean, I've talked with you quite a bit. Any questions you guys have on anything, I'm open. It's, you know, a lot of people help me, and if I can help you, and if you guys can help me out, if you guys have any ideas, anything like that, you know, we're all in a state right now just trying to learn and get better. So just let me know if you guys need anything.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Absolutely. Well, again, I appreciate it. I think this is the last one for this evening, and actually I think this weekend, you know, we try to do something at least weekly, having some, another coach come up and share some ideas. I know Tuesday evening, got Coach Haberkamp coming on talking about tempo and no huddle offense stuff. So, you know, I'm expecting some people to show up to that, and, appreciate you all being here. Y'all have a good evening, Coach Endsley. Again, I can't thank you enough. I appreciate you. And y'all have a good night.
Thanks for having me.